Good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome to all the audience for another session of an ICUC Web CME. When we say ICUC, we talk about Integrated Colloquium for Unraveling Candida Infections. As the topic of the session suggests, in this, we take up difficult to treat cases of invasive fungal infections, particularly focusing on Candida infections, which are one of the commonest invasive fungal infections. And we focus mostly on echinocandins, but the primary focus is on treating invasive Candida infections. I have the honor of introducing two stalwarts as speakers for this program. And I hope my screen is visible to the audience.
Yes, your screen is visible.
Yeah. Okay. Our first speaker today is, as I said, a stalwart, and he is Dr. Ashit Hegde. He is the head of critical care section in Hinduja Hospital in Mumbai, and has been with Hinduja Hospital since March 1988. And we are very honored to have such a senior expert in our platform. He is chairman of the hospital's Antimicrobial Stewardship Committee. He is also the member of the Infection Control Committee as well as the Drug and Therapeutics Committee. He is the associate editor of Indian Journal of Critical Care Medicine. He is the president of ISCCM Mumbai branch, has 33 publications and has chapters in 5 textbooks to his credit. His interests primarily is ICU infections along and the fluids and electrolytes used. I could have gone into details into what are his publications and what are the textbook chapters, but I think I will require many more PPTs to introduce him in detail, but because of shortage of time and to give more time to his presentation, I refrain from that. My next speaker for this event is Dr. Sanjit Sasidharan, and he is HOD of critical care in SL Raheja, which is a Fortis Associate Hospital in Mumbai. And he is an academician to the core, apart from being an expert in his field, has special interest in academics and teaching, and is a guide for the College of Intensive Care Medicine. He's a teacher in Indian Diploma in Critical Care Medicine, again a teacher in Indian Diploma in Critical Care Nursing, is a teacher in Fellowship in Critical Care Medicine. Apart from this, he has more than 40 public. When I say more than 40, there are many, many more, but I just have lack of space and time to go into details, and is an author of books and editorial board member of the international journals. Has been a faculty and organizer in more than 10 national and international courses and workshops. He's a winner of many awards in various national and international forums, has been an invited faculty and guest lecturer in 17 reputed international platforms, no less, and is has keen interest in advanced neurotrauma intensive care. So this is his area of interest. And as I said, for both Dr. Hegde as well as for Dr. Sanjit, I could have gone on and on with the details of accolades that they have and the kind of, you know, expertise that they have. But I think most of you, they being so senior, most of, particularly Dr. Hegde, most of you know. So therefore, I will refrain from going into the details. I will stop sharing my presentation. And I would request Dr. Hegde to take over.
Can you hear me? Hello? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, doctor, you can begin.
I'm heard, right? So I'm starting.
Yes, doctor.
I'm just presenting a case which is just from a basis for a discussion. This is a case of pancreatitis. So day one, this is a 45-year-old male admitted with history of severe upper abdominal pain. His race amylase and lipase, WBC count was raised, and SGOT, SGPT elevated, suggesting as expected a gallstone pancreatitis, and ultrasound confirmed that there were gallstones and the pancreas was bulky. He was treated with analgesics and intravenous fluids and kept NBM as his usual treatment for pancreatitis. On day four, his abdominal pain persists. He had a mild fever and leukocytosis. CT abdomen was done on day four, and that showed pancreatitis with extensive necrosis. He was prescribed injection meropenem. Now, we can argue about whether this was appropriate or not, but today's talk really is not about pancreatitis. It's more about other fungal infections, so we won't discuss that today. And he remained NBM with intermittent RT aspiration. Day six, he continued to have mild pain, but he was afebrile. His IL-6 aspirate was quite high, therefore he was kept NBM. And TPN was prescribed. Again, we can argue that, but like I said, that is for another discussion. And blood sugars were reasonably well controlled in spite of the TPN, with insulin probably. And meropenem was continued. Come to day 14 now, he was relatively well until day 14 on TPN, on meropenem, etc. He develops fever and hypotension. And immediately a repeat scan was done, because after day 14, obviously you're worried about infected pancreatic necrosis. There was no air in the pancreatic bed. Of course, presence of air in the pancreatic bed confirms the evidence of infected pancreatic necrosis, but absence of air does not rule out infected pancreatic necrosis. And of course, as expected, there was extensive necrosis of the pancreas. His blood cultures were sent, and he was scheduled for an aspiration of the pancreatic necrosis. So the question therefore then is, what was the choice of infective agent? This patient already was in meropenem. He has now developed hypotension and fever. Obviously, we're not going to discuss the choice of gram-negative agents, and we'll probably have to cover something like for CRE, etc., gram-positive, etc. The question is, of course, is whether he needs cover for, you know, antifungal cover. Obviously, he needs antifungal cover, because in this patient, he's at risk of two things. One, of course, he can have a central line induced canal infection, and also he's at risk of something called a fungal pancreatitis. Now, what is fungal pancreatitis? Fungal pancreatitis, it is thought that these microorganisms, the candida especially, reach the necrotic pancreas by the inflamed gut. So inflamed necrosis obviously usually occurs after 14 days and manifests with fever, abdominal pain, and worsening of the patient's condition after initial stabilization, as occurred in this patient, until day 14 is okay, and then suddenly developed hypotension. But when somebody develops the symptoms, there are no features unique to say that this is fungal infection. So there is nothing unique to fungal infection in patient pancreatitis. So you should think about this condition in with suspected infected necrosis if they do not respond to broad spectrum antibiotics. Of course, this patient is quite sick. You don't have to wait for so long. You have to start treatment urgently. So, or if they have had one or more of the risk factors for fungal pancreatitis. And what are these risk factors? The receipt of broad spectrum antibiotics. This patient was receiving meropenem. He was on TPN, obviously had a central line. This patient, of course, didn't have ERCP, and his sugars were reasonably well controlled, but he had at least three risk factors for fungal pancreatitis. So clearly, you need to cover for fungal pancreatitis. Of course, the other thing is possible that this patient also, because he had the central line, he had TPN, etc., he was also at risk of a line-induced fungal infection. So both of these obviously merit treatment for, you know, empiric treatment for fungus. So how do you diagnose fungal pancreatitis? So to conclusively diagnose fungal pancreatitis, the candida must grow from the aspirate of the pancreas. So you do you aspirate the necrotic fluid, and if that grows candida or histopathology shows candida, then it confirms that this is fungal pancreatitis. You can send a blood culture, but as we know, one, of course, blood culture can be negative 50% of time. But even if it is positive, it doesn't tell you whether this is a central line induced fungemia or it is infection of the pancreatic, you know, necrosis. So actually, the only real proof is getting, you know, from the aspirate getting fungus. What is the role of, you know, non-culture based tests like, you know, PCT and BD glucan, especially BD glucan? BD glucan, remember, has more of a negative specific, negative predictive value. Therefore, a negative BD glucan in somebody with suspected fungal infections sort of rules out fungal infections, candida, but a positive BD glucan does not tell you very much, because there are lots of reasons for a false positive. But of course, if you keep doing serial BD glucans and they keep increasing, clearly it's suggestive that this patient is likely to have a candidal infection. But you know, again, a BD glucan does not tell you whether the source of candida is from the central line or from the pancreas, because this itself sometimes helps in decision making as well, go along and tell you. So sometimes definite diagnosis therefore may not always be possible, may sometimes be delayed, may sometimes even be falsely negative. Therefore, most often empirically, we have to think of the risk factors that the patient has and start empiric anti-candida or antifungal treatment in sick patients, especially patients who are hypotensive, patients are on vasopressors, patients who have organ dysfunction, you can't afford to waste time. You might have to start treatment. Empirically, you can't wait for definitive results because that might be too late. So how do you treat fungal pancreatitis? Basically, actually, the treatment of choice of fungal pancreatitis is liposomal amphotericin because that has very good penetration into the pancreatic bed and it also covers resistant fungus. Now, in patients who are not very unstable, unlike this patient, patients who are unstable in ICUs where the, you know, the most of the candidal species are azole sensitive, and in patients who have not had exposure to azoles before, you could use fluconazole instead of liposomal amphotericin. But in patients who are unstable and in ICUs where the predominant candida is a resistant fungus, you probably, and patients have had azole exposure before, you probably need to use liposomal amphotericin. There is little knowledge of the penetration of echinocandins into the pancreatic tissue. So at the moment, you know, it's not recommended for the treatment of pancreatic necrosis. But if you know, you think this is not pancreatic necrosis, but you think this is underlying induced infection in patients who are unstable and suspect candidal infection, echinocandins are obviously the treatment of choice pending culture reports. Once you get the culture reports, obviously, if it is azole sensitive, then if the patient is stable, you probably de-escalate to an azole. But empiric treatment of choice in, if it is not pancreatic in patient, if you're suspecting a line infection, echinocandins are treatment of choice. For pancreatic, you know, fungal infections, probably liposomal amphotericin is a treatment of choice. But of course, in whatever you're using upfront, you need to de-escalate to an azole if the cultures come back saying that it is sensitive to an azole. So day 16, the blood culture group candida albicans, the patient was improving. So the questions we have to ask ourselves is, one is, should we de-escalate? And of course, the question when you get candida in the blood is, as always, is should the central line be removed? Now, there is no question that this patient has got candida albicans. It's usually azole sensitive. So the patient wasn't liposomal amphotericin, is getting better. And most albicans, at least in our ICU, are sensitive to an azole. So we would obviously de-escalate now because it's getting better. We also, of course, send a repeat blood culture to make sure that there was no, you know, persistent candidemia. The next question is, of course, why does this question of a central line be removed? Now, for some bloodstream infections, especially staph aureus, candida, pseudomonas, the dictum is that you should remove the central line. Why is that so? Especially for candida, because candida, especially species like candida albicans and candida paraxylus especially, have a tendency to form biofilms. What is a biofilm? A biofilm basically consists of a community of microorganisms that are irreversibly attached to a given surface. They produce an extracellular polymer that provides kind of a meshwork or a skeleton on which these bacteria can, this fungus can grow. They also, therefore, they multiply. So basically, there are two types of, you know, cells. The free-floating yeast, which are growing floating in the blood, they're called the planktonic forms, and the fungi, which are attached, which are very slow-growing forms, attached to the biofilm, which remain adherent to the biofilm. They call the sessile forms, which grow very, very slowly. The sessile forms grow very slowly. They have much higher, much more resistant to the antifungal agents and very, very difficult to eradicate, which is why conventionally the teaching has been that if you have a bloodstream infection caused by candida, you should remove the central line. But this is the universal rule, you know, because, you know, how do you treat biofilm? Now, basically, now that we have the, previously, we didn't have very good agents that acted against the biofilm, but now that we have the echinocandins against the biofilm, of the three antifungal agents between the azoles, amphotericin and echinocandins, echinocandins are the most active against candida biofilms, both in vitro and in vivo models. But however, because they're acting in the sessile films, the MIC of the echinocandins for the biofilm, for the sessile forms of the biofilm, is higher than the MIC of the planktonic forms in the, you know, in the blood, which basically means that if you want to eradicate the biofilm, you have to use a higher dose of the echinocandins in order to eradicate the sessile forms of the biofilm. Also, liposomal amphotericin has a good anti-biofilm when effected at high doses. Therefore, sometimes, you know, patients, especially the patient, if the, you know, the central line is very precious, it's difficult to put in a new line, or the patient has a, you know, precious line like a Hickman catheter or a Permacath, etc. People have tried to salvage the central line by continuing high dose echinocandins and using a lock with liposomal amphotericin. This way, precious lines, or in situations where reintroducing a line is dangerous or difficult, people have tried to salvage the central line using high dose echinocandins along with, you know, a lock, antibiotic lock consisting of liposomal amphotericin. Now, the strategy also, when you use, we're trying to conserve the line, is to each day use a different lumen to give the echinocandin. Don't use the same lumen for giving the echinocandin. You know, each, a different lumen each day, so that you're, you know, trying to clear up the fungus from each of the three lumen, because you don't know which lumen is colonized. So each, use a separate lumen each day for injecting the echinocandin when you're preserving the line. But of course, for most situations, if it is not too difficult to put in a central line, obviously the strategy still remains to remove the center line. Clearly, if the patient is not doing well on treatment, there's no question that you need to remove the center line. Clearly, if the blood cultures remain positive, there's no question that you need to remove the center line. So for most situations, you need to remove the center line. But in exceptional circumstances, you can try and salvage the line. So that is what this question, that is what this review talked about, that you need to balance the risk and benefit of removal of vascular catheters, especially in patients who are having precious lines or where it might be risky to put the vascular catheter. You might try and salvage the line. So in our patient, you know, the other reason, of course, other thing, of course, they say is that if you think that the source of the candidemia is not from the central line, if you think that the source of the candidemia is from the gut, usually from patients who have upper abdominal surgery, patients who have a cancer and neutropenia, in these patients, the source of the candidemia may be from the gut. In such patients, you can preserve the line. So in our patient also, we thought that the source of the candidemia could be from the pancreatic necrosis, but the culture from our aspirate was negative, which basically meant that it was just it was not infected necrosis, it was just a sterile necrosis, which basically meant that our candidemia was from the central line, not from the pancreatic necrosis, which meant that we needed to replace the line if it was possible. That is what we did. We replaced the line. The repeat blood culture was negative. The patient was doing well, so we stopped the higher antibiotics. We only continued fluconazole. Total duration of therapy was 14 days from the last negative culture, and the patient did well. So that's all's well that ends well. I think I will leave the talk. I will stop sharing my slide now and leave matters for discussion at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And I beautifully presented the case. And I would say that you have touched upon a very important topic of biofilms and when or not to salvage the central line. I can assure you that this is our fourth, web CME on this topic. And this is a question that is asked very frequently. And I'm already seeing questions popping up, but we will take it at the very end. So now I will, ask Dr. Sanjit to share his presentation with the audience and enlighten us so that at the end, we can let the audience put in more questions. And at the end, we take up all these questions. So over to you, Dr. Sanjit, for your presentation.
Can you see this slide? Hello, can you see the slide?
Yes, doctor, we are able to see the slides.
All right.
So you need to click on hide, doctor.
Sorry?
The screen sharing is stopped now. You need to share the screen again. I think you clicked on stop sharing.
Okay, I'll go back. Okay, share screen.
Perfect.
All right, I'm going down and that's it.
Yeah, slideshow.
Okay.
And the rectangular tab, doctor, just click on hide. Yeah. Perfect.
All right.
And begin.
So, Hegde sir, thank you very much for that talk. And it is very difficult to follow, Hegde sir. And I've been doing this for quite some years now, and I always marvel with Dr. Hegde's sir's presentation. I mean, it's wealth of knowledge, and there's no doubt that sir is a walking, talking encyclopedia. We've all become foundations with all this hair in our head and all. It's been a torrential time for us with COVID coming in. So I'm going to put up the case for COVID here. So this is a 65-year-old gentleman who was diabetic and hypertension. Was asthmatic, was on regular nebulized steroids and bronchodilators, and last admission for asthma was 2 years ago. So kind of a stabilized asthma is what he had, but he was on steroids. He never went out of the house, and that's what every person who gets COVID says, I never went out of the house. Day one, the illness showed that he had some reduced appetite and he had malaise, and he developed a fever. So he called his local practitioner, and look at the number of medicines that he put him on. He put him on Clexane, Favipiravir, HCQS, Ivermectin, Doxycycline, Keftum, Zincovit, Vitamin C, Turmeric Milk, Kyowa, and Budesonide. So he put him on everything possible, thinking about COVID, and because he's 65-year-old and with comorbidities. So the number of medicines were high, and please make a note of it. He did have Doxycycline, Keftum, and Ivermectin added to all his medicines. On day three, they sent an RT-PCR, and the next day the RT-PCR came out to be positive. When he came out to be positive, that is when the general physician decided, let us just watch him Day five, as home quarantine was going on, he started developing a cough. Now, day one was, he was just not okay. Day two is fever. Day three, fever increase. Day five, cough. So when cough came in, he didn't look okay to us, and this cough became very intractable. That is when the general physician felt, no, I probably need to send him to the hospital. His blood pressure, nothing was checked per se, and he was immediately looked at on the WhatsApp by the general physician. As oximetry showed SpO2 of 92, the patient started getting breathless. It was looking like he was breathless. He was looking wheezy, and that is why the general physician decided to call in an ambulance and shift him to the hospital. Let's recap this once more. Day one, malaise. Day two, fever. Day three, RT-PCR positive. Day five, he started a cough, and subsequently the cough worsened, intractable, and he became wheezy, saturation dropped, started getting breathless, and he was shifted to the hospital. When he shifted to the hospital, this is the time we come in play. And when you look at his blood gas, there was very evident respiratory compromise. There was PF ratios less than 150, satisfying the criteria for ARDS. A CT scan revealed bilateral opacities that we are now very, very familiar with. The IL-6 levels were quite high. CRP was high. Ferritin was high. D-dimer was elevated. Neutrophil lymphocyte ratio was very severely deranged. The LDH was more than 500. Troponins were high. The clotting index also showed 6. And immediately we started the patient on IV remdesivir, 6 milligram dexamethasone, high dose vitamin C, high dose irinostatin, a helmet CPAP with an FiO2 of 80% is what was required. Clexane was started at 0.6 BD. Now this is what we had. This was a clear-cut cytokine storm. There was definite release of interferons, tumor necrosis factor, interleukins, and CSF in this case. And now we know the ACE that we're using is tocilizumab. So we did use tocilizumab day four. I mean, the first day we did use tocilizumab, day two, day three, we saw some kind of improvement on this patient. We were still on helmet CPAP. And on day four of tocilizumab, the breathing got better. So around 4 days later, the breathing got better. The saturation went on to 92% on NRBM. Plus what really happened was the ferritin levels came down. The CRP was just hovering around 40 odd. The neutrophil lymphocyte ratio came around, reduced further. And LDH came to around 300. However, we found the BP to be slightly borderline. And a patient had a vague abdominal pain on day four post-tocilizumab. Now, this patient, mind you, was on a helmet CPAP. And because he was on a helmet CPAP, we couldn't feed him very well. He was on TPN for the last 3 days or three, 4 days. We had put him on TPN because he was unable to even come off the helmet even for some time. So we put him on TPN. Now, day five. So day four was the time of tocilizumab, was the time when he started feeling not okay, and the BP was kind of borderline. Day five, what happened? There was a significant drop in blood pressure, and we had to add a small dose of vasopressor. With a small dose of vasopressor, his blood pressure did come up. His WBC counts had gone up suddenly to 26,000. Ferritin was 4,000 again. LDH went to 520. So and as usual, you know, when there is a patient, there are 100 phone calls coming from all over the place, and very, very, we didn't want to do it, but we then added another 200 milligrams of mid-dose tocilizumab again, thinking that this may be a repetition of a cytokine storm. Now, this was a combined decision by everyone together to give another mini dose of tocilizumab. We did that. We also sent blood cultures, and we anyway started the patient on meropenem, teicoplanin, and fluconazole. So he did receive tocilizumab 24 hours, two doses, one big dose and one mini dose of tocilizumab, thinking about cytokine storm in this case. Day six post tocilizumab, there was again a significant dose drop in blood pressure. The vasopressors were added. Higher doses were required now. In fact, patient went on vasopressin. A small dose of adrenaline needed to be started because the cardiac output was showing very low on the cardiac output monitor. The WBC counts further went up to 36,000. The creatinine was 2.9. The ABT showed a lactate that was 26, our normal is 20. Procalcitonin was 2.9, LDH was 520, and we converted this patient to echinocandin. Now, this patient wasn't doing well, and significantly 5 days after this blood culture, or 6 days after this blood culture, we got this from the line, from the peripheral line as well as from the central line. So this was the growth that we grew. We grew Candida auris and Enterococcus faecium. This is what we got from the blood culture, and this patient was intubated, was ventilated for severe acidosis and respiratory distress. day six of intubation, even with the best possible management, FARSI monitoring and esophageal manometry, we were unable to ventilate him well, and he died of multisystem organ failure. So here the questions that came to us, we did think about what happened to this guy. So we thought maybe what was the source, we were not certain. What was the line, whether the line was the source, we were not certain. Whether it was primary fungemia, we were not very certain. But let me just give you a small primer on tocilizumab. So tocilizumab, from real new studies, have really indicated that some kind of improvement that sees in 7 or 14 days. But these are all observational studies that came through. And on day 14, we saw we see the best oxygenation improvement. That is what we consider while doing tocilizumab. Why are we giving this? This is given because of the fact that at high CRPs, the ones that we showed in our patient, there is some kind of improvement in a 14-day survival. Again, these are observational studies. They are not randomized controlled trial, but clearly indicating when there is a very strong inflammatory response, the survival rate of patients definitely are kind of improving, at least in observational studies. There are no comparators. These are all single center studies. So at least in these observational studies, it does show that tocilizumab has some role. Another study that came out also showed a very similar picture with a 14-day case fatality coming down in patients who were treated with tocilizumab. Again, a retrospective cohort study, even the 28-day case fatality rate came down. But what's very, very important? What's very, very important is, apart from the fatality rate, the most important part is the patients definitely had super infections. Now, these are studies that have come from the United States. These are studies that have come from Italy, where probably the incidence of infection is much lower than what we have in India. So this is this may not be significant for them. Those patients who got super infected in their cohort of patients didn't die. But in our country, if our patient gets super infected, there is going to be problems because of the fact that we have a very high load of resistant bugs and resistant fungi in our hospitals. Now, this is a study of all those patients who had novel coronavirus pneumonia in Wuhan, China, and they did find out that there was definite almost a 4% incidence of fungus, and those fungus, out of which three were Candida albicans and one was Candida glabrata. Characteristically, all of those patients were very, very severe COVIDs. They were, most of them were mechanically ventilated. Study, however, debunks that, which came out some week back, which actually says that the incidence of bacterial or fungal superinfection is very, very low. However, there are other studies that also say that there is a significant amount of fungal infections, and those patients who had fungal infections, they normally died. In fact, group D, what you see, is the severest of the severe patients, group D. And in those severest of severe patients, you can clearly see the growth of Candida is definitely on the higher side. And those patients who had Candida, the blue lines are the ones that had Candida, died. So it clearly indicates that if you get Candida, if you get super infected, if you get a fungus, the chances of survival go very, very low. What is my incidence of candidemia in my hospital? In my hospital, the incidence of candidemia is somewhere around 5 to 6%. Neutropenic patients, unfortunately, those patients who had candidemia, many of them died, two out of three died. Non-neutropenic, almost half died non-neutropenic, and they were all associated with very long stay and presence of TPN. Now, well, if you ask anybody what is the commonest in India, everyone says it's Candida tropicalis. However, it's not mine. My specimens, when I looked at in a study that which we published in 2017, had a very high incidence of Candida albicans, 37%. Non-albicans were 41%, but we didn't have a higher incidence of Candida tropicalis. In fact, albicans still outnumbered everything by 49. So you look at the distribution, albicans was 49, tropicalis was 17, glabrata, and we didn't have any oris. Subsequently, a year later, we actually studied colonization of central lines. When we studied this colonization of central lines, we found out our first oris. Our first candida oris that came out was in this study, that is around 1.5 years back when we actually published this study, which shows candida oris, a percentage of 1.7%. For 2017 publication, there was no Candida auris. Whereas in a publication in 2019, we start getting Candida auris. Now, this Candida auris was the problem, is what I feel, in this patient. Well, let us understand whether we went wrong somewhere or what we could have done separately. Was this bacterial sepsis, that thing that came to our mind? Could this just bacterial sepsis, nothing more than bacterial sepsis? Well, to distinguish bacterial sepsis from fungal sepsis, there may be three ways to do that. One is to look at severity, the other is to look at lactates, and the other is procalcitonin. Well, there is a study that was done way back, almost 20 years back, which actually said that more than 70% of candidemia septic shock patients had multi-organ failures. So definitely it goes on to say that those patients who had candidemic septic shock, they have multi-organ failures much more than that of bacterial sepsis. And they are catastrophically, the presentations are very, very catastrophic. And they take a very, very long time to come out of this when they have multiple organ failure. So definitely severity-wise, the fungus seems to be much more problematic as compared to the bacteria, where the mortality rate was almost to the tune of 60% when compared to bacterial sepsis, where the mortality is 46%. We also had in this group a lower lactate as compared to bacterial sepsis. So lactates are on the lower side. Probably it goes in favor of fungal sepsis rather than bacterial sepsis. And that's what our lactates were. It was not very high. It was barely around 26. And another thing that probably we can look at is the rise of procalcitonin. Well, it is in the study that was done 6 years back. 6 years back, we had procalcitonins. If they were not very elevated, it may signify that this patient probably has fungal sepsis as compared to bacterial sepsis, especially candidemia. Well, if you look at the cutoff for ROC curves, it looks like 6.08 is a very good cutoff for looking at the negative predictive value, which goes up to 96.3. So it does look like if procalcitonins are low, very, very low, it may not be bacterial sepsis. It may be rather fungal sepsis. So procalcitonin, severity, and lactates, these are three things that are very, very different from bacterial sepsis. Of course, it's a clinical gestalt that works in these cases. But what was our diagnosis in this case? Why didn't the diagnosis come in? See, cultures are something that we send. However, it took 5 long days for the cultures to come back. It takes a long time before the cultures come in, and that's what causes the biggest issue. By that time, all is everything is lost. So the blood cultures take a jolly good long time, and significant amount of time does get lost when we are actually looking waiting for blood cultures. And that's the reason that non-culture based tests are so important. Beta D glucan, as sir said, Manon, anti-Manon, T2MR, SACTA. These are the ones that probably are non-culture based tests, which may help in indicating that this patient has got a bacteria, a fungal infection, and thus help us to start an antifungal earlier. Am I using scores? Yes, there are so many scores that are there in literature, but we must understand that the positive predictive value of these scores are not very good. In fact, among all the scores, if I put my patient, it's only the Ostrowski's Eichner score actually that tells me that this patient probably may fit into a fungal infection kind of a condition. That is why the negative predictive value of these scores are very, very well. So in fact, if the scores are negative, then you could probably rule out or maybe not start an antifungal is what it looks like. So that's what the ROC curve of these particular scores tells. So scores are good to know. It may give us an indication that this may be fungus, but it is not dichotomous. We cannot say, yes, it is fungal infection or nothing more. And that's why the combination of a predictive model, looking at TPN, looking at abdominal infection, severe sepsis, those scores that you look at, plus on an echinocandin. So did that delay of 24 hours for that matter make a difference? So we do feel that because it's very clear from the study that was published in the Antimicrobial Agents Chemotherapy in 2005 by Matthew Morrell, which actually said that if you delay the antifungal even by 12 hours, the percent hospital mortality does increase majorly. In fact, the microbiological clearance also increases once you do antifungal treatment after 12 hours. So even 12 hour delay in the start of an antifungal treatment, biological clearance will increase the duration of intensive care and the hospital length of stay. Probably this would have made a big difference if I would have started echinocandin much earlier. In fact, those patients receiving adequate therapy and adequate source control survive much longer than those patients who don't receive adequate therapy and adequate source control early. That is, even a difference of 12 hours does clearly make a difference, as shown by the study done by Matthew Bassetti. Delay source control here. Now, this patient had only two things that I could think of: a vague abdominal pain, the X-ray chest did not show anything, it was only the central line that was there in place. So did we delay source control, and did this make a difference? Would it made a difference if I pulled off the central line, put in a new central line, especially this was day 5 post tocilizumab? So I think this, the central line probably was the source over here. And if you look at it, the patient had almost 4 days of central line, only 4 days of central line, but probably because of the high dose of steroids and and tocilizumab. This was very, very important. And it's so important to understand this because a study that was recently published actually showed even if you gave antifungal, even if you gave adequate antifungal, that means soil control is more important than the adequate than the antifungal therapy. For that matter, both go hand in hand, clearly indicated by this study that when we do not do adequate source control, the mortality really didn't change, even if we give the right antifungal. So giving the medicine is not the idea. Getting the source control and giving the medicine is the right idea. And when they looked at all the variables that made a difference in mortality, they found out that source control was the most important among the whole group. What's my stop drug in my ICU? My stock drug in my ICU is echinocandin. I don't use fluconazole at all. Irrespective, there are studies that say that the patient is stable, but if the patient is stable, the patient doesn't require the ICU in the first place. So in my severely ill patient, I think there is no role of fluconazole. There are studies that say that if this patient is azole naive, if the patient is clinically stable, you can start fluconazole. But it's very important for us to understand that empiric therapy in these conditions of situations where you're giving immunosuppression has to be with the best possible drug around. And it is very clearly evident from this study that said by Martin Poleff that said if you give an echinocandin as an empirical therapy, they lived more as compared to those patients who received fluconazole or voriconazole. So the antifungal versus fluconazole for invasive candidiasis clearly indicated that anidulafungin was given as compared to fluconazole, these patients remained alive and fluconazole therapy very clearly. So this was one study that clearly proved that the echinocandin scores over fluconazole in invasive candidiasis. Now, why in my hospital I don't use fluconazole? It is probably because of this study. This study we published 2 years back, where we actually looked at the entire candida that we had in our hospital. And what we found out was the percentage of fluconazole resistance was 16.2%. So definitely a patient in the ward, I may think of using it if there is sensitivity, but in my ICU, if the percentage of resistance is somewhere around 15 to 16%, definitely I don't want to use fluconazole. My stock drug would remain as either micafungin or caspofungin. And if you look at it, our sensitivity to micafungin seems to be much higher than that of caspofungin. Will I change line over guidewires and retain precious line still cultures? Never. With the new advent of new techniques, new ultrasounds, we are getting better in putting lines, and even with platelet counts as low as 5,000 and 10,000, we end up putting lines without any problem. I would never try to retain my precious line take that chance because the patient will not give me a second chance. Probably I will remove my line and pass in a new line if my line is a source of infection. That is primarily because of the fact that study clearly indicates, this is a study by David Andes, which clearly indicated that those patients in which lines, even precious lines, were removed, their mortality was significantly lower than those patients in which the lines were retained. So removing the line is very, very important. What happens when we have repeated positivity and appropriate antifungal therapy? Obviously, we have to look for metastasis in the eye, in the back, in the lung, in the brain, and probably alter the PK/PD of your antifungals. Do I treat candiduria? No. And again, I would say no, I don't treat candiduria at all. Unless the patient has undergone a urological intervention and has candiduria, or is a liver transplant patient, or who has preterm low birth, or it's a preterm low birth weight baby. What happened was, we did have this candida auris. Unfortunately, what happened was, one candida auris went on to the second candida auris, went on to the third candida auris, and we had probably, by that time, three or four candida aurises that came across, and these are known to cause endemicity. If they are known to be endemic, they're going to be resilient, they're very, very difficult to treat. These candida auris are a problem to treat in the ICU. 2009, I had one case. 2019, 560. In US, 2019, there were 560 cases. And I feel large number of these cases were missed. It could have been probably more than that. That is because candida auris is very difficult to diagnose. It is generally mistaken with candida himaluni. So I think there were this 560 cases would is an underestimation. It probably would be much, much more. And that is why in 2019, towards the end last year, there was a very important global challenge of Candida auris to be done in intensive care, which include AURS, where it basically said that this is something that spreads very quickly, and it's a very resilient kind of an organism. It is very difficult to treat, and it's got resistance to many mechanisms, and it has to be a large-scale surveillance needs to be done in order to prove and in order to take this Candida auris out of the equation. Thank you very much for the patient hearing, and all these slides could be accessed on the website www.drsanjit.com. Thank you very much.
I do not know, because I had not seen your presentations, but one of the important points that you talked about, whether to salvage the central line or not, is something that is a very burning topic in the ICUs. And in fact, we have 250 plus strong audience, and the questions were already pouring in. So I was just, you know, clubbing them together so that we do not have an extremely long session. And I would start with the questions which have come earlier. I have changed, tweaked the questions a little to combine many of them together so that we save some time. So one of the things that Dr. Hegde talked about are exceptional circumstances to salvage the line. So a couple of our audiences, in fact, more of them wanted to know, you talked about one of the instances where you could actually salvage, you need to salvage the line. Or some of the instances where you may think of salvaging the line, you talked about if you feel that the infection is from the gut. So audience wants to know what could be the other possible instances where you could need to salvage the line. Doctor,
from the gut, it is not salvage. Gut, it means you can retain the line, because the source of the candidemia is unlikely to be the central line. It's likely to be the gut, translocation of Candida from the gut. That classically happens in cancer patients who have received chemotherapy because of mucositis. Can happen in patients who have had upper abdominal surgery, and the source of the Candida could be the abdominal infection itself. So there, you know, they have bacterium candidemia because secondary from the gut, and that may be sitting the central line. Those people, maybe source control and, you know, all that is more important. There, maybe the central line is not the primary source of the candidemia. So that's not really salvage. There, you could probably afford to retain the line, especially the patient getting better. The question of salvage occurs when you know that the central line is likely to be the cause of the candidemia, but because it's a precious line, or because, you know, you're worried about difficulty in putting in a new line, then you try and attempt to salvage the line. Now, Sanjit says that you should never do that. I have thought about situation that I think he should also talk about that, because my only question is that people are now questioning this thing about this, because, you know, they say that now you can probably try an antibiotic lock therapy along with high dose echinocandin to, you know, try and eradicate the line. That is really, I agree with him that for most situations, you try and remove the line. I'm talking exceptional circumstances. Suppose the patient has grossly, you know, thrombocytopenic. Of course, he says you can give platelets and do it on ultrasound. I'm just saying, sometimes you have no other, you know, access available in the ICU. So it happens, patient, especially with, you know, on dialysis, where you can't use a subclavian when, you know, you don't want to use a femoral. So you have no other access available. You don't want to do a guide wire change. All these things are there. Sometimes, you know, there are situations where you actually absolutely run out of other sites to put in the line. In those situations, you know, you might try to salvage the line, but then you need to use a higher dose of echinocandin, and you need to use an antibiotic lock, because you need to use, use a liposomal amphotericin through the each of the lumen in between use. And like I said, if you're using it, then you try and rotate the, you know, the echinocandin dose each of the lumen. But these are, as has been mentioned, exceptional circumstances. By and large, the rule I agree is that you try and remove the line if candidemia is the, you know, is from the central line, especially with Candida parapsilosis. There's almost no doubt that parapsilosis is very likely to cause biofilm. So if this parapsilosis, almost certainly that the source of the infection is on the line. There is no question that you need to remove the line. But sometimes you have this, you know, like I said, situations where in cancer chemotherapy, gut surgery, other, maybe you can keep the line because you need to tackle the abdomen first. But these extreme circumstances of putting in a new line is either dangerous or very, very difficult. You might think about it. That's the only question. I think Sanjit also can talk about that.
Yeah. Dr. Sanjit, you would like to add on this?
So the only time, sir, I have retained the line is when the patient refused for a new central line. That is the only time that I've not been that I've retained the line, and that is the time when he did not give consent. So I probably agree with Dr. Hegde that there might be, I have not come to a situation where I have been told to retain the line. But in that patient, yes, I struggled with that patient with the line in place. In fact, that patient received almost 24 days of echinocandin therapy along with liposomal locks. I mean, it was crazy. Very, very long therapy. And every time we again cultured, again we got fungus. And every time I went and counseled, again they said, I don't want to put a new line. So we gave almost 24 days of therapy to get rid of that fungus. And subsequently, I was so surprised. There were lines all over. I could easily have put a line, but this is the only instance where I have saved a line. I would not try to do this. Yeah.
So sometimes the patients are chemotherapy who had thrombosis of the lane. Sometimes it, you know, dialysis patients where all the access is gone. So, you know, difficult. Sometimes they have only one access left.
Yeah.
I agree. But by and large, the rule is remove the line. I'm not saying that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. I think while you were answering, one question has propped up, which will, you know, make our understanding complete. One of the audience has asked from Jaipur, Dr. Sanjeev. He says that if it is Candida parapsilosis, which is the cause of biofilms, still we need to choose echinocandins only in higher dose in case we wanted to retain, or should we think of other agents?
That's a very tricky question. Now, for parapsilosis, they're supposed to have a higher MIC for echinocandins. And top of that, for a biofilm, you need even higher. So I would think if it is parapsilosis, by and large, you try and get rid of the line. In the very, very exceptional circumstances where you have Candida parapsilosis and you want to retain the line, which again, by and large, you should probably, you know, it's a more of a theoretical, but if it does happen, I agree that maybe you need to use liposomal amphotericin or fluconazole IV and, use a lock with liposomal amphotericin. You obviously need to get it MICs. If you get it MICs and it is sensitive still, of course, you might be able to use. But if the MICs for the echinocandins are higher, you obviously can't use an echinocandin. Then quite often Candida parapsilosis is sensitive to fluconazole. So you get your sensitivity, you can decide what to, you can use. Empirically, you can use liposomal amphotericin. Then when you get your MICs back, you can probably decide. But your lock will have to use liposomal amphotericin.
Yes. Dr. Sanjeev, you agree with this?
Yeah, absolutely. If there's Candida parapsilosis, as sir said very clearly, the first thing would be to get the line off. It's very difficult to actually treat it because parasilosis PSP is plastic, and unless plastic gets out of the body, parasilosis will take care of the body. That is what's going to happen. So that's one thing. The second thing is, yes, as sir said, liposomal amphotericin would be the only way to do it. And definitely we'll have to pray to God that there is no nephrotoxicity with the high dose of liposomal that we'll be giving. So it's very difficult to keep retain the line with parasilosis, and I hope I don't get into that condition anytime.
Right, sir. Sir, the next question, I think it is directed to Dr. Sanjeev because it was part of his presentation. And before I go to that question, Dr. Kanti Utka from Mumbai, I hope your question was, is it advisable to use an antifungal agent in ICU for more than 10-15 days? I think that question has already been answered, so I'm not taking this question up. Next question is, one of our audience has asked, what is the accuracy of non-culture based test in terms of predicting whether it is a fungal infection, sepsis due to fungal infection, invasive fungal infections? How much do you...
Yeah. So in non-culture based techniques, the two techniques that are available is the Manon-anti-Manon Manon antigen and anti-Manon antibody plus the beta-D-glucan. We are not doing the SACTA or the PCR based analysis of fungus. Now, PCR is not being largely validated with large validation studies. So PCR for fungus is not something that it may guide you, but it's not something that has been validated largely. Beta-D-glucan is something that can be done, and this got all sort of cutoffs. One is 80, and if you go up to 200, the sensitivity specificity does go higher when you go to 200 cutoff. But as sir said in one of his slides, doing it subsequently one after the other, and you see a rising trend, that possibly will give you a good idea of beta-D-glucan to Candida. But you must understand that Candida for parasilosis and Guillermo-Mondi, these are two places where beta-D-glucan may not rise like the way it should rise. And the other problem is, when you're doing beta-D-glucan and there is deep-seated infections, it may not be very well validated. So in deep-seated infections, this beta-D-glucan may not serve its purpose, especially when it is very, very deep-seated infections. But it does give you a guide. The sensitivity to rule in an infection is not as good as ruling out an infection. In fact, these are very good drugs, very good things to rule out an infection because the negative beta value is very, very high. But yes, in a combination with beta-D-glucan along with the presence of a rising titer of beta-D-glucan plus the presence of a clinical gestalt, a clinical feature, plus the presence of some kind of score will definitely narrow your diagnosis towards a fungus, and that would be the way to do it.
Right, sir. Thank you very much, Dr. Hegde. We'd like to have your opinion on this also, sir.
I agree.
Well,
like you said, I think Sanjeev spoke about in his talk as well. You combine your, you know, he's talked about lactate, PCT, your clinical gestalt, yes, and all those things. So I think it's a combination of things. You can't have just one factor. So you use everything. You use your clinical suspicion. You use these tests. But as he said, most of these things are more to rule out than to rule in. To rule in, you know, quite often it's very difficult. So quite often, you know, we end up probably over-treating, but we have no choice. And at least you, when you get a culture's negative, and if your suspicion is low, if you get, suppose now you've started antifungal in some gram-negative growth, maybe if you'd stop the antifungal therapy, you know, if you've started it temporarily for everything. So, I mean, I think all of us in a sick patient give everything, but ultimately, you know, once you get the cultures back, then you decide which one to stop. But, you know, I think most of these things are more or less to decide not to use, but not so much to use. And even having said that, in a really sick patient, I think whatever your clinical score, whatever it is, we all end up giving everything, because even though it's a 90% sensitivity, there's still a 10% chance you're missing the, you know, the boat. So I think in a really sick patient, we probably are over-treating, but we end up giving everything because we can't afford to sort of miss a treatable cause. So anybody more than 10 days in the 7 or 8 days in the ICU and critically ill, we probably end up giving a, at least empirically, but then stop if it grows a gram positive or a gram negative. That's what we do.
Yeah. Sir, Dr. Narendra from Delhi wants to know that he has, since Dr. Sanjeet has already highlighted the increased incidences of Candida auris globally, and he's seeing cases in his hospital also. But Dr. Narendra specifically wants to know your experience, if any, with Candida auris incidences and how you are approaching that. A question is to Dr. Hegde.
Actually, until we moved to the COVID ICU, we did not have Candida auris in our ICU. The surprising thing is now that we have moved to a COVID ICU in a separate building, I really thought that our infection rates will be lower. But actually, surprisingly, we're seeing many more resistant infections, both gram-negative and Candida, in our COVID ICU. Maybe probably steroids, tocilizumab, I don't know what. Or maybe other thing is because we are short-staffed, the nurses are not practicing infection control as much as they were in the regular ICU, because obviously the nurse-patient ratios are, we have a shortage, so we have a lesser ratio. So I'm the first Candida auris. In fact, until recently, we were very proud to say that we had no Candida auris. But now, in our COVID ICU, we are seeing Candida auris. And as already been talked about, it spreads very, very quickly. So we really require very, very strict infection control measures. You need to wash your hand with your alcohol-based cup. Also may not work like a C. diff. You probably need to wash your hands properly. You need to isolate that patient, and which in the COVID ICU is very difficult to do all that. But you need to isolate. And, you know, most important thing really is infection control. That's a really big thing in this patient. That's the main thing, that otherwise it's going to spread through your ICU, through your hospital very, very quickly. You really, really need tight infection control. And like I said, in our main ICU, we had a very, very tight infection control committee and very tight infection control nurses. But unfortunately, those people don't enter a COVID ICU. Obviously, they won't. So I think infection control has taken a back seat. And as a result, we've already seen 3 Candida auris in a COVID ICU in the spell of 3 months. So it's obviously all boils down to how good your nurse patient ratio is, how good your infection control is.
Yeah, that's a scary situation, sir, certainly. There is another pathogen that is being, you know, we have 4 questions on that, and I am just reshaping the question so that all the 4 questions are answered. They are asking that they are also seeing, some of the doctors are also seeing down, mostly 3 of them are from down south, they are seeing increased incidences of Candida glabrata resistance. What is your experience and what do you usually choose if Candida glabrata is the implicated pathogen?
Sir,
it's to both of you. Dr. Sanjeet, you can start, sir.
I have a very small proportion of Candida glabrata, but the first drug of choice here would be definitely an echinocandid. There is no doubt about it. The fluconazole resistance rate is very, very high. In fact, it is intrinsically resistant to cruzei. Like cruzei, it is even intrinsically resistant to fluconazole, I feel. And echinocandid is always the first choice, along with extremely superior source control. Unfortunately for me, the glabrata rate has not gone up. I still am dealing with albicans and auris of recently. That's about Glabrata. Yeah.
Sir, your opinion, Dr. Hegde?
Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, we can.
Hello?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
So about Glabrata, you're talking about Glabrata. See,
I mean,
basically, you have something called dose dependency. So at least initially, obviously, your treatment of choice is going to be echinocandin, as Sanjita said. For most situations, you're going to use echinocandin. But obviously, echinocandin is worried about cost and this and that and about de-escalation. So then you need to look at the MICs. Without the MICs, it's very difficult to know whether, you know, you can use fluconazole. So, but fluconazole sometimes exhibit what is dose-dependent sensitivity. If you look at the MICs are not very high. You could probably afford to use a higher dose of fluconazole purely for the purpose of cost. If costs are not an issue, obviously, I would continue with the echinocandin. But if you want to, you know, avoid an IV drug, or you want to switch to oral drug, or you want to move them out, or you're worried about cost, you have to look at the MICs. The MICs are, I think, up to 1632. What are you talking about? Microbiology, if you can use fluconazole in high dose, we've gone up to 1,600 milligram of fluconazole in patients with normal renal function to use for treatment of Candida glabrata, where the, you know, the MIC suggests that you could get away with a higher dose. So if you want to treat glabrata with fluconazole, you have to look at the MICs, need to talk to your microbiologist, and then decide if you can, if it is safe to use fluconazole. You can, but initially upfront, at least in a sick patient, at least initially you have to use a echinocandin. The only question is about de-escalation.
But when we look at fluconazole on a weight-based dosing regime, should we use the ideal body weight or should we use the actual body weight? That's the question that always comes to my mind, because you have 80 kilo patients and all, and if we just look at it as 12 milligram per kilogram, then we are looking at a very, very high dose, isn't it? So do we use actual body weight or do we use ideal body weight? I think we lost Ashish Hegde.
I think his signal connectivity is. Okay, Dr. Sanjit, in the meanwhile, I will just take a very quick question. Means probably it's not focused on science or. I will skip that question also. I will come to a question that is being asked in the usage of various echinocandins in your setup. Actually, this question is to both the experts, but I would take your feedback. Amongst the echinocandins, the newer ones as well as, okay, sir has logged in from other. Hello, sir.
No, you lost me. So that's, I mean, I think I lost.
Yeah, no problem, sir. Dr. Sanjit's question was, while using these drugs, do you take the actual
Fortunately, I thought I lost it. I thought I was happy I lost the connection. It was a difficult question to answer. You talked about the weight and ideal body weight, or I thought connection was lost at the right time. So anyway, you're talking about, I would think you would go about, you know, because actual body weight in the ICU can change because a lot of the fluid shifts, etc. So I'm not sure you're talking about the so I think you would probably prefer to go by ideal body weight and all that. I would need to refer. I really don't know. I think that I must admit that I don't want to answer something wrong. I don't know. I'd rather check that.
Sir, one question that has come is, amongst the choice of echinocandins that are available, the earlier one was obviously caspofungin, and the newer echinocandins has come. Do you use echinocandins based on the pathogen indicated, or you have other criteria of choosing that? And what is your experience if there is a differentiator? So I'm clubbing various questions so that to make it concise. Actually, these are separate questions. So probably what my understanding is that the audience wants to know that amongst the echinocandins choice that is available, is the choice of an echinocandin for a particular patient based on a pathogen or his condition or any other criteria?
I mean, honestly, for Candida auris, there is some evidence, not great, that maybe mica fungin is better than the other Candida auris, but it's not, what you call, not such a great difference. But some people seem to say Candida auris, mica fungin is supposedly better. For all other Candida, I don't think there's anything to choose amongst the three kind of candidates in terms of efficacy. Sometimes they say for patients with established liver disease, maybe caspofungin should not be used. Maybe you need to use an anidular fungin. That's again is, you know, some, that's one theoretical consideration. Sometimes you're worried about patients on transplant who are on, you know, multiple immunosuppressive regimens, and there's a question of drug interactions. Again, there you find, you know, decide to use one of the others depending on the drug interaction. So the one is, of course, liver organ dysfunction. Probably anidular fungin that way is the least, you know, effective, because clearance is neither kidney nor liver. So maybe anidular fungin that way is safest. For auris, maybe mica fungin. Maybe you worry about drug interaction selectively. That's one situation. But otherwise, for all practical purposes, 95% of the time, I think, doesn't matter which one you're using. Like I keep telling, it probably depends on who sponsored your last trip, but that's just a joke. But otherwise, indication doesn't matter. But in some situations, yeah, it does. You might have to descend depending.
Yes.
So,
Dr. Sanjeev, your experience.
So I have a slightly different take on this. When I actually did my specimens, all my isolates that I basically got in two candida, rugosa and famata. Rugosa, candida famata, and candida rugosa, the MIC pattern for mycofungin was very, very low as compared to the rest. That was one thing. But when I started practice, we initially were thinking only of caspo because that's the first drug that came in. So we talked about caspo all the time till liver transplant started occurring, and then we started forgetting caspo because anodula fungin came in. When anodula fungin came in, there was one particular study that was sponsored by Pfizer where anodula fungin was actually looked at with fluconazole, which showed superiority. So that anodula fungin made me start anodula fungin to most of my patients. But later on, when I looked at my sensitivity pattern, the resistance pattern was same, 6.3%, 6.3%. With both Candida, with mica fungin as well as anodula fungin, and only looking at species Femata and Rugosa, probably I would probably use mica fungin because all my Femata and all my Rugosa have been more sensitive to mica fungin as compared to anodula fungin. But yes, it is both, as sir said, you know, it's very difficult to choose between all three, and anodula fungin and mica fungin probably are safer as compared to voriconazole because of the drug-drug interactions and because of the metabolic profile of how it's going through the liver in caspofungin.
Right, sir. Sir, we are running out of time, but there is one question. Though I do not know, Ms., you have actually partially answered this question already, particularly Dr. Sanjeev, you said that the first 12 hours are critical, and in fact delay of initiating an antifungal therapy could be detrimental in terms of saving or losing the patient. One of our audience has asked, if cost is a constraint in treatment, is it wise to initiate if we see that the patient ultimately may not be able to afford an antifungal if it needs to be given? Will it be wise to initiate fluconazole at least because that could be more affordable rather than not initiating any antifungal agent?
So to answer that question, you should know the pattern in the hospital or in the ICU. So if the resistance pattern is anywhere upwards of 15% to fluconazole, then that is not the drug that can be given. That is definitely not the drug that can be given if the resistance pattern is more than 15%. For all practical reasons, this bug might be resistant, and that's the one of the reasons that probably the patient is very badly septic. So the better option would be to give a proper conventional amphotericin. A conventional amphotericin will have a broader spectrum, a more fungicidal action, and at the same time would be cheap also, rather than giving fluconazole, especially in those patients who are severely septic and in septic shock, because it's been proven that fluconazole probably is not a great drug to give in these kind of cases.
I was hesitant to ask this question because I didn't look like a very serious question, but beautifully answered, Dr. Sanjeev. Dr. Hegde, you agree with this? Because I think this is a challenge that is being faced.
As he said, you know, the patient, clearly your flora in your ICU are sensitive, less than 15% resistant, or the patient not been exposed to azole before, or the patient not desperately, maybe you can get away with fluconazole. But I think when you look, I've realized, you know, after so many years that when I try to save cost, ultimately I've ended up spending more money. I think if you look at the entire pharmacoeconomics, that even one day extend the ICU, ultimately the bill is going to be 40,000-50,000 rupees. You try and save 5,000 rupees on a drug and you end up spending one day more in the ICU. That itself is, you know, ultimately in this larger scheme of things, pointless. So I really think we'd look at the bigger picture. you know, if it's say, if by giving an echinocandin kind of, you can save even one day in the ICU, I think ultimately you're saving money. So I really think, I realized, you know, the hard way that when I tried to save on small stuff, I ended up actually spending more for the patient. So now I really, I think ultimately it's very unlikely that any patient is going to go bankrupt because he spent 5,000 rupees extra a day. It's very, very unlikely. I think, I really, really think that we should focus on saving lives. And I realized in our country that, you know, we ultimately, in the process of trying to save money, we probably, you know, I know we all trained in medical colleges, we all trained in public hospitals. So that whole thing of trying to save money is always there with us. But I realized in the hard way that when I ended up saving money, I tried to avoid doing tests, I tried to avoid doing, you know, not putting lines and this and that. I ended up ultimately either killing my patient or making them spend more time in the ICU. So at the moment, honestly, I stopped thinking about, I mean, I don't unnecessary costs, of course, certainly not. But if it is required, it is required. That is what I've decided now. Because ultimately, a lakh rupees more after a year, if a patient is alive, doesn't matter.
Right. Sir, before...
COVID times, people are not having an income, but the main thing is to save alive. I think a priority is to keep somebody alive. Money will always earn that money again. So that's...
Yes. So we'll take one last question that has, you know, we have got a reminder for that. Dr. Anita Gitwani from Mumbai, and she wants to know empirically which antifungal to start in a nursing home setup in septicemia or ARDS.
Sir has already answered that question, I think.
Question is already answered. So yeah. I think we will not go into detail.
But suppose in ARDS, I don't think you should start fungus because fungus almost never causes ARDS. So I don't ARDS. Think there is no reason to start an antifungal drug in an ARDS patient, certainly. Because candida as a cause of pneumonia is almost unknown. So
yeah,
it's a different issue. But as a cause of pneumonia, if you're saying the ARDS is caused by fungus, almost never. So no point.
Yes. Right, sir. So, sir, with that, we will come to the end of Q&A session. And I need not say how enlightening the session was with the quality of questions and with the how intently your presentations were followed and how the questions were asked would have given you an idea of how enthusiastic our audience always has been. And, sir, this also gives both the speakers a message that in various platforms, I think the knowledge about treating invasive fungal infections in general needs to be spread more because this is still a less explored area as compared to when it comes to antibacterials. So thank you very much for being in this session to both the you know, expert speakers here, and we are highly obliged and we learned a lot, and I'm sure our 250 plus audience strength, as I saw last, would have learned as much, if not more. I, as a layman, learned a lot of things. So thank you very much for being here. And we wish to see both of you in many of our other platforms, which we use when it comes to antibacterials and other antifungal agents, areas like aspergillosis, mucor, etc. We would like to have your thoughts on those topics as well as and when we do these programs. And thank you very much. Before we close this, your... one comment from Dr. Sanjit and Dr. Hegde. First, Dr. Sanjit.
As sir said, life first, money later. Stay safe, and probably I mean the words that sir said was absolutely right. I have also I am learning this now that the patient is first. Forget about the money. The money is come later on. And of course, I've burned my fingers many times, but I feel very satisfied when I do everything possible for the patient at that particular moment.
Sir, one comment from your side, sir.
Sanjeev just wrote my comment. So I think I'll just say plus one more to them. That right. So I think thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Have a great evening, whatever is left of it. And thank you so much for joining in, sir. It was great interacting with you and learning from you. Thank you very much, sir.
Bye, sir. Bye. 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 Bye.
Thank you.